I think Jantz is our superhero of the week. Let's give him a round of applause for making it here. So, I was very pleased when Jantz shot me an email some time back saying he really wanted to get back into doing some classical music. And I was more than happy to put him on the calendar. Little did I know, or little did he know, that the weather was going to be such an obstacle. But you're all here, and Jantz is here, and so I'm going to turn things over to him and be prepared for a wonderful hour of music.
I don't know if it'll be an entire hour of music, but... Close enough. Well, I see you all didn't get the note about the dress code for today, but I suppose I can go ahead and play it anyway. I'm just teasing. I all these years as a musician, and I've never owned my own tuxedo until just this past year. So I thought I would dress up today because this is a serious recital, and I'm a very serious musician. If you haven't figured it out by now, I'm kind of sarcastic, and I like to have fun and poke fun at us classical musicians for how we can sometimes behave. As Renee said, I emailed her maybe a month or two ago, and I said, hey, I would love to do a program with some classical stuff, and I really enjoy playing your piano and your facility, and she said, sure, so we set up a date. So I was realizing this makes 15 years since I've given a respectable length classical solo recital on piano. So 15 years ago, I graduated with my undergraduate in piano performance, and that would have been the last time that I gave a recital like this. So I appreciate you letting me do this. Obviously, if you know that I'm the director of music at Midland First United Methodist Church, I play every Sunday, but it's just different to do a solo classical recital. So I hope you enjoy. And if you don't enjoy a certain piece, in 5 minutes it will be over and we'll be on to the next piece. So, enough of me talking, let's get started. The first piece will be Felix Mendelssohn's Song Without Words. And he wrote a lot of these. He was quite prolific and famous for these, especially the Song Without Words for piano. Back in the day when everyone had a piano in their home or in their lounge, and it was very customary, you know, this was like having a radio. This is what you listened to, was your daughter or your wife or your children playing the piano, and so they needed all this piano literature, sort of like salon piano type music, so this would have fit that kind of bill. After that, I'll play a piece by Frederick Chopin, and then I'll talk a little bit more before I play the Haydn. Thank you. strained relationship with his wife, George Sand, and never did get to return to Poland, so had kind of a sickly presence about him. He was known for not always being healthy, fairly reclusive, often only performing in front of very wealthy patrons or things like that, so not a lot of public exposure. But for someone on a completely different vein, Franz Joseph Haydn was kind of a happy fellow. He was in the thick of the classical period. He was musically gifted as a young boy, sent to the outskirts of Vienna to be a choir boy, and then his voice broke, and once his voice broke, they kicked him out of the boys' choir. But he then, because of his musical prowess, he managed to get back on his feet and ultimately landed a job in the Esterházy court, where he remained for, I want to say, at least 30 years, writing endless symphonies and piano pieces and all kinds of music. He was very well treated by the Esterházy family for most of his life, and was, as a contrast to a lot of other musicians, he was very well known and very wealthy during his life. The other musicians in the Esterházy court respected him so much they called him Papa Haydn. So they he had a very good working relationship with all the musicians at court. And he was also extremely famous in London, and is most famous somewhat for some of his later symphonies, which they called the London Symphonies. So he was one of those classical musicians who enjoyed fame and fortune during his life, unlike a lot of musicians who were composers who are often famous after their poor and untimely deaths. So Franz Joseph Haydn, this is the opening movement of his Sonata number 60 in C major, very happy and lively in a classical style. And if you're a real musical buff, you would know that I'm leaving out the repeats. And if you aren't a real musical buff, then you won't care that I'm leaving out the repeats, but it will still be fun to listen to. Thank you. next, Clair de Lune from the suite Bergamasque by Claude Debussy. Some of you have heard me play a setting of Jesus Loves Me that incorporates this tune. This time I'm, or it's not a tune, this piano work. This time I'm actually just playing the Debussy piano work today. But it's kind of hard to actually do that. Like sometimes I find myself wanting to veer off into the other direction, but I'm going to stick to the page. But so this is as Claude Debussy envisioned this piece. And after that, a piece by Johannes Brahms. And it's one of his intermezzos, which intermezzo means in between. So I don't really know what it's in between, other than I think it's just a name that he used for some of his pieces that could have been played between acts of an opera or things like that. I don't really know. But anyway, I just think it's lovely, and I wanted to play it for you today, so that's why it's on the program.
Thank you.
should have brought more music. Alberto Ginastera might not be one of the big composers that you think of, like Beethoven and Brahms and Mozart and all of those that come to mind. excuse me, he's a composer from Latin America. I believe he's from Argentina, and that's why these are the Argentine dances. And he wrote for piano and orchestra. I guess I would mention, if there's any pieces on the program that might offend your ear, it's going to be one of these. And I guess I'm a classically trained musician, but even I don't necessarily like walking into a symphony hall and then just being assaulted with a bunch of sound that doesn't make any sense to me, and I don't understand what the point is or what the composer was trying to do. So I think to paint a picture for you about Ginastera, similar to periods in painting and in art, right? You have the classical period, you have the Renaissance, you have Impressionists, and then you have people like Jackson Pollock I'm blanking out on the name I want to come up with. But you have modern art, and you have romantic art, and you have all kinds of things, right? And some of them look like beautiful pictures. And then you have other artists who do abstract things, and they just throw paint on the canvas. And it's not so much about that they're trying to paint something that looks real, as much as they're experimenting with color, or texture, or contrast, or things like that, or form, or mixed media, right? So it doesn't necessarily look like a painting of a bowl of fruit. Van Gogh would be another example of this. Van Gogh's paintings didn't look photographically real, but they were nonetheless beautiful, right? Or at least most of us might think that some of them were beautiful. So I would say Ginastera comes from an approach where not all of this will be tuneful, and some of it will actually be quite dissonant. And I guess if I would say in these three dances, the first one, the Dance of the Old Herdsman, the two hands are actually written in totally separate keys. So if that gives you an idea of how it might be dissonant, and it's more about rhythm and pattern and energy than it is about, what I would say, a beautiful melody. Like, you're not going to hum the melody after I get done with that. The Dance of the Beautiful Maiden is this kind of melancholy 6/8 time dance that I would say is what I would call ugly beautiful, if there is such a thing. That it kind of is ear-bending, but there's something very satisfying even in the midst of kind of the things that don't quite fit to your ear. And then the last piece is Dance of the Outlaw Cowboy, and he uses words like violent and savagely in the piano part, so it's quite aggressive, and I will apologize if that's not your thing. But then after that, we'll have something much more pleasing to the ear. But I wanted to include these three works just because they're very different than what I've played, and they're all three very different from each other. But I didn't want to do a whole program of music like this because I'm not sure that an audience wants to sit through that. But so anyway, I offer them Argentine Dances by Alberto Ginastera.
Thank you. over in 5 minutes, I promise. Loosen up after.
Thank you.
Thank you again. Thank you.
I can't think of a nicer way to spend a blustery winter afternoon than listening to some of that wonderful music. And I was thinking perhaps a Dance of the Gaucho Matrero should be called Dance of the Michigan Winter. It seemed rather stormy to me. But thank you so much for Jantz. Let's thank Jantz once again for being our hero. Thank you for all the great recital and feedback today.
Thank you all.